I've called this Schools for the 22nd Century. I'll get into why in just a moment. And Reframing Education for the Global Collaborative Innovation Age. We'll talk about that as well. These pictures I did not take, but they're certainly lovely from one of the prettiest spots on Earth up by Navi's in Newcastle. Many of you know that spot. Maybe 10 or 15 years ago, you went around it to get to Nelson Bay or Port Stevens. Now you might want to stop and enjoy because it's a gorgeous spot now that the coal dust isn't as prevalent, and a bunch of people from Sydney actually make it their vacation spot since it's relatively close and so pristine. I want to give my deepest appreciation to Dan and the team here for the invitation. It's my honor to be here. And appreciation to all of the great educators who have allowed me to be here today. I stand on their shoulders, the great teachers I've had all the way through who have inspired me and given me the chance to do what I do. So it's in gratefulness to them as well. I want us to get into, so why do we even have schools in 2014? Besides to be places that we need children to go while mom goes to work. What would it look like if we reframe them? I'm using that term instead of reform deliberately. We'll see if that makes sense. You can push back on any of this, by the way. You got to put this thing on, though, so you may want to wait to do it. What the notion of inspiring children, reclaiming that idea, and that'd be a pretty good one. I want to start by sharing some of the perspectives that each of you would do in a similar situation, about what motivates me, what makes me tick, and some of the people in the thinking processes. I could choose a million, I've just chosen a few, but I think it really starts by understanding the notion of schools and the role to promote democracy. We'll talk a little bit about that in the second presentation, but I see that's what we're all in on, is promoting freedom and democracy and the opportunity to improve the common good. And since I went to the University of Virginia and was a government and economics major there, any of you who might know that part of the world, any of you had the chance to go to Charlottesville? Charlottesville, Virginia is one of the prettiest spots in the U.S. in the rolling hills of the Blue Ridge Mountains. Thomas Jefferson invented the United States, you could say, the Declaration of Independence, which basically said taxation without representation, we're done with that. And on his tombstone, he asked that the Declaration of the Rights of Man, he didn't say woman, he should have as well, is the leading on his tombstone. He wanted a more spiritual document to actually be what he was remembered for first. And the founder of the University of Virginia, which is an amazing architectural place. You don't have to go to Greece or Rome. You can go to the just on the lawn there and see all the buildings. And he also invented public education because he understood that everyone needed to be well educated for freedom to survive. And if you look around the world today, it's really education is the missing piece between us getting things right and not. And he did so in 1816 when he had that quote. Some of you in your postgraduate work may have studied Ron Edmonds. Ron Edmonds was the sort of inventor of the effective schools movement. 1979, he basically said, we already kind of know what to do to help all children be successful. It's really about the adults in the room and whether we're willing to play nice. Play in the same sandbox. I have a few colleagues right now that literally won't play in the sandbox together. I have to have separate sandboxes for them, and they play quite well. That may be one of your issues. It's interesting how we already know how to get schools right. We don't even need an app for that. Ron Edmonds' work really started that process. And you know what the number one characteristic is great school leadership. You don't have a great school without great school leadership. You can have great teaching in part, but you don't have a great school without building leadership that is absolutely the tops. And that's what separates it out over any other variable. Edmonds' work started us on that journey. There's been a lot of iterations since. Maybe some of your mini thesis or thesis got into some of that. John Dewey's philosophy about schooling and society and the preparation for future. Some of you are in school settings where you're building those themes in. We're going to get kids involved. We're going to make schooling about the journey and the destination. For me, it was mostly, why do you need to learn this? Because it'll be on the test and you'll need to know it later. And somehow I bought that. We can't really get away with that much longer. And maybe we couldn't then, I just didn't know how to push back. Nelson Mandela is one of my heroes of the 20th century. He spent 27 years, 19 in one prison area in Robben Island off of Cape Town, South Africa, which had the honor of visiting and reading his diaries and really studying that instead of choosing violence, chose education in building the Republic of South Africa. And they have a long way to go, and he himself had to overcome the tendency to push for violence first, but actually his understanding that education was the most powerful weapon and still is, if you look at the hotspots around the world today. So we owe Mandela a lot. And I think this one probably is the best takeaway you might have all day. If you do go to the GP and your plants, her plants are not really well, you might just go down the street to the next one. It might be indicative of a place that might not be healthy in more ways than one. All right, so to get us warmed up here today, let's take a little quiz. And let's see, does everybody have a mobile or a portable device where you could do some texting? And if you don't, could you share with your partner at your table? We're going to use a polling software called Poll Everywhere. Do any of you in the schools you are in or work with use the formative assessment tools of clicking or texting? Is that happening in many places? Where, like if we had studied last night about camels and what is in their humps. That was our assignment. I'm not saying it's in the curriculum, but let's just say it was. And we did a little reading, and I wanted to test whether you've done the reading. We can use these tools now to gauge formative assessment. It's the kind of teaching we want to promote, because if you all get it right, I don't have to reteach it. We can move on, assuming it was important to know what's in a camel's hump. And then, if not, we need to reteach. And quite often, we just wait too long till it's 2 weeks later, 2 months later. In some of the testing schemes, months later, we get data back. And that would be the same way as your doctor calling you in about 9 months saying, you know, you have an iron deficiency. It might have been nice to know the time you visited the doctor. All right, so here we go. I've tipped the question, first question. So what is stored inside a camel's hump? All right, I've only given you four choices. Who cares isn't one of them, so sorry about that. Water, if you believe it's water, you'll type in as your text message 411956. That will be the equivalent of water, fat, muscle, and hair, or these other digits. So if you could go ahead and push text, then count to two or three, and let's see if we're live and it's working here. If not, we got to reboot the wireless system, but I think it's good. I think it's good. With Dan's help, we've got it working. All right, so what I like about these tools, without a lot of learning curve, we've got ourselves now interacting, and I'm quizzing you on the lesson on camels and humps. This is a not very sarcastic group, because no one's entered hair yet, but I usually like to give one foil for what I'll call the smarty pants in the room, because they were going to be disruptive no matter what, and it gives them an outlet to be funny, right? So if one of you hasn't texted in, it's okay, you could put hair, and then I get to know, I probably would know who it was. They're just the ones saying, I wonder what he'll say if I put hair. There are newer versions of this that allow you to draw answers and do some more interactive things. They'll push to your iPad. You can do a lot of variations. You can have solve problems. You can do much more than this as well. I encourage you to think about with the teams you work with. I've worked with school principals around the country and now around the world who were trying to deal with issues with their central administration but wouldn't speak up. Like, should we do X or Y? And they knew their leader wanted Y, so nobody would say X. And by doing this, they're often people were more willing to have a dissent, particularly if that leader was so strong or it was a budget-cutting time and they didn't actually want to be cut. Also, for those of you that don't have the device with you, this is what it feels like in a school that uses technology and gives you the assignment to go home and create a PowerPoint with a video and bring it back tomorrow. And that kid is in a home where there's third-generation unemployment. They don't have high-speed internet access and don't have the savvy. I just left you out of this activity. That's what it feels like. And so many of our schools are doing these things, but the gap between those who have access and not is getting wider. So I didn't do it to hurt you or punish you, just to make that point. All right, so, does anybody know this? Have you gone to Anna Bay and ridden the camel? It's a great place to go. It might be really, really sorry you did on a 40-degree day, but it's a wonderful spot. So, most people would say water, but camels have three stomachs where they store the water necessary to go across the arid desert. So actually, fat is what's in the hump of a camel to give the protein and the energy to make it through. So three of our colleagues either guessed right or knew this from their schooling, or they took the camel ride where they tell you, guess what's in that hump you're sitting on. Now, this could be in one of those trivia things. Just use this as an example. If this was important to know, how do we change schooling so the kids actually learn it, not that we guess they learned it, and they know it right now, not later on the test. Formative assessment is one of those things that we can change. Plus, if we were quite certain it was water, where'd we get that misconception? What else are we teaching kids that could be wrong just because we're convinced it's water? I use this example. I'll get you on a couple others here in a minute. See how that goes. And in the second presentation, we're going to do some math problem. So just we'll get you in every which way. All right, so inside our body, we have blood. And which do we think is the color most likely to be if we were inside our body and like, honey, I shrunk the kids and went in the body? Is when we describe blood inside the body, not outside when we bleed, but inside, as red, white, blue, or clear, and you'll enter those digits for the answer you propose. Many young people today would say, well, I could just Google it, and I'll get the answer. Why do I need to know anything? And I think that's pretty fair, except shouldn't we establish that there is some content that no matter whether Google was live or not, or whether blocked by the government, that we could get the answer right. But many of you might say, that's something I really don't need to know. I could figure it out. There's a different point for this one. We'll see how it goes in the answers. Yep. So if we were on the Millionaire Show, and I was stuck, and I was asking the audience, and I'm going for the million. I've got one lifeline left. I could phone a friend, or I can go. I might as well phone the friend too, right? Because I have one question left. So let's assume this is it. Would I go with blue for the million? Are we so sure in this room that blood is blue that I should go for it? $1 million. Do I surrender and keep the 500,000? Surrender, Dan wants me to surrender. So clear is not a bad answer, because if we take a centrifuge and we spin the blood, we get plasma. Yep. So white, you've all seen white cells. They get overpowered by either red or blue. So there are white cells in the blood. You've seen them, right, when you have an infection. So now the question is blue and red. And whoever said blue that doesn't mind disclosing that, why do you know it's blue? Why do you believe it's blue?
Unoxygenated.
I'm sorry?
Unoxygenated.
Unoxygenated. So somehow when you cut yourself or you bleed, the oxygen turns the blue blood red.
So depends on where you are in the body. That's how.
Oh, okay. Excellent. Sorry. I may have given a different answer that I've heard. That's another one I've heard as well, which is that the blood going to and from the heart is slightly different color. If it's unoxygenated, it's blue, and then when it runs through the lungs and gets the new oxygen, it turns red. Okay, excellent. Sorry, that was a good clarification. Someone else may have thought what I just said, because that's what I was taught in second grade. It was in the textbook that was used as well. Anybody think here the blue bloods? So any of you with British ancestry you come from the blue bloods. Well, that's like you're the Tudors or something from an era. It's really nothing to do with blood. It's true blue, and blue is like if you're going to root in the origin games for New South Wales, you're wearing blue. It's not really related, but it's something that might have been a myth that's brought forward. So blood in the body is red. Now, coming to the lungs after being deoxygenated, it's a little lighter red or pinkish, and with it, it's a little more cherry colored, but it still will call it red. Blood inside and outside, this oxygen thing when you cut yourself is all hooey. It's just misconceptions. It's the number one misconceived science concept in the world. Still being taught in schools around the world, mostly in Western schools, but the teachers were taught it. Most primary teachers still today are teachers that don't like math and science, that chose primary education, and now reinforce their lack of liking it by teaching the textbook and not doing their homework and not really checking out that some of what we're teaching them is actually not correct. And they'll count kids wrong for not really realizing that blood is red. Now, you could argue it's not red, it's cranberry or it's wine. We could do a test of this morning. If I had a beaker with water and just a little bit of milk and a red pipe cleaner. And if we got the color just right, we would see that red pipe cleaner make it look as if it's blue. Just like my veins look blue through my pale white skin on the inside. It's just the refraction of the light through the water or through the skin. And we could do a science experiment, have everybody figure that out. That'd be something that'd be interesting to test. So what else are we teaching that's wrong? I use this point, not that this is something that I even got because I was taught it wrong. I'm not trying to catch us. What I'm trying to do is to think about what else are we teaching that we're so fundamentally sure of that is either obsolete, incorrect, or that young people couldn't figure out and help teach themselves even better than we did. Some of the stubbornness I see in my own staff about teacher education is perpetuating things that are actually not the way kids learn. Like if we teach anybody to highlight now, highlighting is a task maybe to keep yourself awake. It does not influence memory at all. It's a busy work task. But many people would say a great study habit is to highlight. Remember, no, it might be your habit to keep your mind motivated, and if it works for you, it's good. If it leaves you with a marker to come back to a quote you want to remember, it's good, but it's not going to trigger memory. You'll just say, oh, I need to remember where I went highlighting. You won't remember what you highlighted. So it's not a bad thing to do. It's just not going to lead to more learning. It's a specific skill that isn't really necessary, although it could be helpful. What else are we teaching? All right, have I got you mad at me yet? I've only been here 15 minutes. All right, currently in China, they have a leader that's the head of the Communist Party of the People's Republic of China, also the equivalent of the president. And that person is either Zhang, Hu, Ji, or Deng, and I'll let you text in who you believe that is. I did this at a high school in the Newcastle region a couple weeks ago, and the kids said, who cares? This isn't anything we need to know. I did it with a group of principals a couple weeks later, and they said, this is one of those things we should just Google. It's just something you don't need to have in your memory banks. I'll try to correct that attitude momentarily. Now, each of these men is or was, so this doesn't have a bad answer. It just has one that's more correct. Oh, good, we got it. Sometimes, if we had a large group here, we'd see some of this scatter. Really good guessing is going on, right? It's scattering across. All right, you can set this device also so you don't see the results till the end, in case the first person that texts in influences the others. So if I know Dan's really good at this, I just wait for him to go first, and then I'll just copy it. Even if it doesn't count, people still want to be right. So in this answer, we've improved our scores from the previous question. Xi is the current leader of the People's Republic of China, the president, the head of the Communist Party. How do we know this? Where did you know was Xi? He was just in Brisbane last week. Tony Abbott was in Beijing just several months ago. Most of the audiences that I talked to today, including the one at the new professor's talk in just a few months ago, don't get this right. They'll have one or the other, usually one of them that's a former leader. A year and a half ago, when I said who was the leader of the People's Republic, it was right, because who was the leader? And it was really clever. You go, who was the leader, and it was who, and it was, oh, that's funny. Now it's who was, but it's Xi. And the reason I believe we need to know this is that particularly if you come from where I come from, just above in Newcastle, I call Xi our boss. And I think we need to know our boss's name. Usually you know your boss's name. Just in the last year, the Chinese government bought half the port of Newcastle. It is the world's leading coal shipping port. I'll do a video of that just in a little while and show you some of it. The other half is bought by a holding company of a shipping interest that's fully a subsidiary of the Chinese government. China owns the coal, or buying the coal, and they own the port that is shipped through. And somehow, in the world we're in today, it's cheaper to ship the coal that's Australian to China or other parts of Southeast Asia to make a t-shirt or a trinket or something, ship it back to Woolies or Kmart or Target and sell it to us cheaper than if an Australian made it. We wouldn't have made all that coal and all that shipping. Think of the irony of the use of resources and energy and of people power, mostly exploiting the labor there. And in the United States, exploiting the labor of the people who sell it at places like Walmart, who don't have fringe benefits and health insurance on their part-time hours because they're cheating the system, and now with Obamacare, they just employ them for 29 hours a week because you don't get benefits till you get 30. The exploitation of people around this notion of who's whom. The United States owes the most debt in the world to China. And if he called it in, which he won't, because then they would go under, he could influence the market. He could invent your super just by making that decision that we're going to call in some of the debt. Interesting. If you had to pick a couple of leaders in the world, I think he's one of them that we might want to know. Most every child in Australia knows Barack Obama. I'm not sure they could tell you who the premier of their state is. And I'm not even sure they could tell you Tony Abbott. So in those cases, who's in charge really does matter. We've got to get it to the point we actually figure out how to get people to know that. So good job. We got G. We would have won the million on that one. So in the life of a child, what does the current research say is the most important influence on learning? There's a lot of other answers. Each of these is right in part. Is it the parent support, their teacher quality, the socioeconomic status, or the student motivation? We have a tie here at teacher quality and socioeconomic status. So John Hattie and many of the great researchers from Australia will tell us that the number one variable that influences a child's life is their motivation, 50%. And of the balance between that 50%, the largest percentage is teacher quality. So you could argue that point. So student motivation is 50% of the pie, and of the other 50% is the teacher. Some research out of the Education Trust in the States that's taking similar demographics of children, similar kinds of schools, and similar teacher quality, because they have access to the whole United States, and compares like year 3, 4, and 5 in math. They found that actually teacher quality trumps them all. That the influence of the quality teacher, particularly back to back to back, outpaces socioeconomic status, student motivation, and parents. So when I rank these, although you could argue each of you is right, number one is the quality of the teacher. Number two is what the student brings to the table, their motivation. Number three is their whether they have a parent who is available or a peer who's available to guide and assist, because we're in school only part of our lives. And so having an adult who's highly influential with that child. And number four is socioeconomic status. In fact, the least important in any of the research is the class of the kids. Some of you represent schools that prove that every day. Now, it's in the top four, so it isn't irrelevant. But of those, it is the least relevant if the others are very strong. So with great teaching, with a little bit of students caring about what they're doing and bringing it to the table, and a little parent support, we can do anything. We can overcome any of the baggage that children might bring to school. That may be worthy of discussion. So, let's shift gears and try to get this going. I've sort of set you up, warmed you up, tested us a bit, talked about, used some technologies maybe to change what we do. Now we'll talk about rubber duckies, because I knew this would be why you came today. You wanted to hear about rubber duckies. Yes, the bath toy rubber duckies in 1992, a cargo ship was sailing from Hong Kong to Seattle. And you may remember this, happens all the time, but this was one of the big times. A storm hit, and 29,000 rubber duckies, turtles, and frogs fell off in these big cargo bins that maybe stuff shipped around all the time. In fact, when the Malaysian air jet, which is still missing, was somewhere off of Perth, we're not north, south, west, probably not east, they found all this stuff, and a lot of it's because it just had fallen off the ships, and they mistook it for possibly the plane. When these turtles and frogs and duckies fell off, they started drifting around in the ocean. And 15 years later, they were still drifting. And their map movement looked something like this. So they left from Hong Kong in January 92, northwest of Hawaii. The storm knocked some cargo off. And they started circulating around in the brine and the swirl and all that. And went up through the Bering Strait and around the Arctic. And down, and 15 years later, branded in Britain, in Ireland, and in northeast of US, These are authentic. They were like the actual duckies just floating through the currents. A little cold by then. Interesting, they didn't stop in Canada. When I get to some points about reform that this is going to be about, Canada hasn't adopted some of the policies that I will tell you are dangerous that Australia has adopted. Even some of them made it here 15 years later. The rubber duckies went from Britain to the US, a little bit to South America, and they made it to the shores right off of here. What do the duckies have to do with things, particularly influencing the public schools? I think you all have the opportunity to pick and choose some of the bad policies, but some of them may have migrated to your own policymakers. Education reform as adopted in Australia has typically been influenced by the UK and the US. It's manifested around the notion that higher standards are just intrinsically good, that we need this 21st century workforce. Can't really argue with that. We need high stakes assessment. Would we want low stakes assessment? Would we? That's all based on improvement is driven by competition, punitive testing, rigor, and accountability. Right, these are these claimers of these policies that seem to be, particularly for the politicians, real good sales pitches. But what about poor and minority students, students with learning differences, and the understanding that actually achievement gaps, which haven't closed in 30 years in the UK, the US, or Australia, the difference between majority and minority students, there are certain schools where they have. They are solely the exception, where they close with quality teaching, not a testing regimen. All right, this is projected wealth in the world this coming year. And the reason I go here is why the urgency of this is on our plate. If you look here, Africa is basically a deflated balloon or a pop balloon. And you'll notice North America slightly inflated to its geographic size, and Asia, particularly around China, India, and Japan and Korea, bigger than its size. Australia smaller, but not because of its relative wealth, it's because there's only 23 million of us. The good news out of this picture, which is not too good if you are in a deflated balloon, is that the population of middle-class families and the wealth of the world has shifted in the last 100 years from here to here, meaning that half of the middle class of the world now live between New Zealand and Korea. And what middle-class families want is a great education for their children. That's job security for some of your teachers and leaders, as families choose great education. And Australia does not have the same poverty, the same space crunch, the same really totalitarian and ugly government that China is, if we want to admit it. India is really wrought with amazing brilliance, but lots of issues. Australia could be the renaissance in education needed in this century to turn it around. If Singapore with 6 million can do it, it was 4 when it started, if Hong Kong can do it, even if it's a subsidiary of China, if all these countries that are smaller can turn it, Australia's got more wealth, more dynamism, and a much better infrastructure, and great keen spirit, and a sense of fairness that's rooted in everybody's culture, that I think makes Australia the education century. We may have missed the boat for solar power. That would have been a good one to lead in, but maybe we can do it in education in this next generation. In Finland, you know, the model that's been magically presented there, a few of you have had the chance to go and visit and study, what they do is prepare, support, and trust teachers. It really isn't magic, right? They respect, not inspect. They eliminated national testing. They have curriculum frameworks, and they do spot testing, but they don't have national tests. Yet they're one of the highest in PISA. It's gone down a little bit just because when you're so high, you're going to drop down, and Nokia forgot to make a smartphone before Apple and Samsung did, which didn't help. And they also believe that their assessment system is going to be around open-mindedness, critical thinking, involvement in the community, and infusion of the visual and performing arts. Where do we assess those currently? In the UK, the US, or Australia? Those things which create a dynamic learner that could be part of that team that gets us to be the educational leaders, making education the number one export of the 21st century for Australia. So what do we learn for the rubber duckies? This is really an international movement, led by a lot of political influences way outside of our pay grade. It's about the privatization of the public space. I was mentioning to Dan earlier that any of you live near or go through the Epping Station on the train. And you realize that the new line that's going up northwest is being privatized, and the tunnel that they built is 30 centimeters too small for the current New South Wales trains to fit deliberately, so that there's no way in the future the government could buy it back and have the trains run. So literally Epping will be a private station boxed out of the current New South Wales trains, just so we can have a smaller train that has to be built so you pay extra like you do to go to the airport. I realize I'm only here a year. I could tell you a lot of dumb examples in the U.S., but that one doesn't make sense. For the common good, it makes sense to have a tunnel too small. Even if we need to privatize it to get it done, wouldn't we leave the tunnel big enough that we could run any train through it, just in case we're boxing that out? That's the kind of thing we've got to take back in terms of decision-making. That's because privatization has taken over. And privatization is led by profit and greed, not the common good. My theme for reframing schooling. Choice isn't always democratic. At the Woolies I go to in Market Town in Newcastle, there's a whole aisle of cereal, breakfast cereal. There's so many choices. They're all high fructose corn syrup, most of it not very good for us. There's a few, but the choice doesn't make us better having all that choice. It actually could make us worse because none of it actually is good for us. They actually don't sell food that's good for us at McDonald's. There's not a lot of stuff they actually sell there that's good food. It might be quick and easy and cheap, but that doesn't make it good. Some of those same trends are coming into the education space, coming into the teacher education space with programs like Teach for Australia, built on Teach for America. 5 weeks, become a teacher. Watch a video. Would you go to a doctor if you'd had 5 weeks training and watched a video? I'd go someplace else, even if their plants were dead. We've created testing centers instead of learning centers, and I realize most of you run institutions that have gone way beyond this, but I still see, unfortunately, that mostly schools are places young people go to watch their teachers work. And the purpose of it still seems to be testing instead of learning. So if we turn it around in learning, testing would be one way, not the way. And even our most successful kids today still believe that they're in competition within their own class, and not two kids in Mumbai who will wake up today to be their boss. That we've got the structures in reframing schools still pedestrian, that somehow the school itself is the unit of measure, or the suburb, or the community, rather than the global sphere of the most well-educated in the world. If we make it about learning, testing is one way to determine if we're getting there. And many, many schools have changed this and flipped it. That's part of my thinking about reframing. Value-added measures are worth a whole conversation depending on how much you have to buy into them. I just read an article on the train on the way down confirming some things I've written about previously. Value-added allows us to determine what growth of students might be based on their prior tests and will project what a teacher might expect this year or next. And they're very interesting measures, the same way BMI is to measure your body mass index. Gives you some indication, but it is a very imperfect measure. In fact, it's invalid to use it to measure teacher quality. That is 1 to 14% likely to measure anything to do with teacher quality, which means it's invalid. In the States, whole states have adopted it as the teacher evaluation system, leading to firing of teachers over something that actually is not legitimate. I believe in the public sector, you'll see in the next year a new evaluation system proposed, and it will be based on value-added as some perfect science. And we'll just have to push back and tell them the duckies have come, and this one we're not just accepting that package. So let's shift to what's possible. So Gutenberg invented the printing press in 1439. And if you think about that invention changing everything, it quite extraordinarily influenced our lives. Because from 1450 to 1800, Europe went from having almost no books to a billion books. You know, prior to that, most of the reading that took place was in the monasteries. Religious leaders, spiritual leaders, had the Bible, they had other spiritual documents, and they could read, so people had to go there to listen to them tell the stories and pass the traditions along. So we went from almost no books to the people, to now people had access to books. Gutenberg's invention sort of created, there's a lot of other sociological and economic reasons, sort of created the reason we need schools and teachers. Because if now there's books, we need people to read. If we need people to read, we need somebody to teach them to read. Now, it helped when the Industrial Revolution meant we didn't need children as much in industry, or in agricultural revolutions, we didn't need them as much on the farm. I know there's a long story, but it doesn't help my point, so I'm skipping that part. So here's the output of books from 1450 to 1800. Like, pretty extraordinary. But more than 500 years later, Brin and Page invented Google. And in 1997, Google changed everything and jump-started what I call the innovation age. Really, the possibility of sharing information have never been the same. If you compare the two, I think they're pretty similar, but at a level of exponential change, it's quite extraordinary. So if it took 450 years to get a billion books, it's taken Google 17 to have a billion sort of sites that you can go to, and 60 trillion pages with a billion discrete searches. Sorry, I got that backwards. So 60 trillion pages are indexed, and every day a billion searches, some of them legal, which is the good news, right? Some of them take you to places that are not necessarily where you ought to go. So there's about 2.5 billion of the world's 7 billion who have access regularly right now. Those are in the countries that are mostly bigger on that map of wealth. As you do percentages of the world that have access, we have a majority of people in North America, in Australia, New Zealand, in Europe, less than that in the rest of the world, with Africa really falling further behind. However, the mobile phone has changed that, because in most of even developing world, in sub-Saharan Africa, there really is the opportunity to use a cell phone as the mode of banking, of communication, of finding information. There's lots of NGOs doing great projects that are changing that, maybe not as ubiquitously as having Match.com on your laptop. Top five languages. You might expect English, but by next year, China will be the top language on the internet. How does that change developers and what they're thinking about in terms of Mandarin being the number one language? We haven't really thought of that in terms of how many of our schools are teaching Mandarin fluently so that the kids could be web developers for China rather than Chinese being web developers for us. An interesting way we might want to infuse the curriculum a little differently. Chrome is the leading browser. Would you have guessed that if I quizzed you? You might have said Explorer because that keeps popping up, but Chrome has actually taken over. So Google's got us there as well. The uses of the internet are for research, looking for jobs and other things. I'm not sure if they count looking for a new partner on research, but we might have to count that. If you look at what's happened on the other side of the internet, a lot of it's done in sort of scandalous, scurrilous, and immoral ways. But a lot of it can be used for great potential. How much of what we do is around the ethical issues in using the technology for the betterment and the common good? It's one of the pieces of leadership that I think principals in my region are all saying we need more of, because both kids, teachers, and us, and apparently a lot of members of parliament are willing for $10,000 to lose their career, and imagine what's possible on the internet to do for less than that. So I think we've got to really build the ethical component back in, particularly in the public space. You all have that front and center, but it might need to really have a job to do with the internet space. 144 billion emails are sent each day, almost 70% are spam. That's just not the one you didn't like. Spam means junk. Wow. Google has 88% of the market. We were going to do some marketing of our programs on campus, and one of our marketers wanted to do something on Bing, because you pay different fees you go to different sites. Bing? Anybody use Bing? I use Bing when it comes up automatically sometimes in some sites, but then I get away from it. Only because I trust Google to take me there. Who convinced me of that? So Google got us wrapped around its finger. But you see, second to that, way below Yahoo, Bing, and the other browsers. Kids today are on social media 3.2 hours a day. We're going to have to take some of that back for the common good. But in some ways, my sister, when I was young, we had this thing called a telephone, and you had to dial it. And it was on a long cord, and we only had one in the house, and it extended from the kitchen. And you could bring it to the closet under the steps. If you tucked it just right and took the extension and you went over about here, she could talk to her boyfriend 3.2 hours, and I never got to use the phone. So I'm not sure if teenagers are using it any more time distracted from their education or anything else. It's just the power of this is, to anybody in the world, to do anything good or not so good is a very different reality. At least she was probably only talking to one person at a time. Now you could be talking to anybody, anywhere, who may or may not be who they say they are. Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, the number one sites. How much have we wrapped into our educational space the opportunities to take advantage of those sites? When we get to the second session, I'm going to have you develop a Twitter profile that you don't have to use. and it can be larger than 140 characters. We're going to talk about our leadership vision when we get there. But Twitter has changed everything. If there's really traffic between here and Newcastle, the news won't get it till after it's too late. Twitter will have it. It's just amazing. In the Boston Marathon bombing of about a couple years ago, Twitter solved it. General public solved it. The newscasts at the time were hesitant because they didn't have confirmed sources. So the first photos of the bombing and the first knowledge that one of the guys who did it was in a boat in somebody's backyard all came through Twitter. It changed what news is. And have we changed education around that? That's great. But as a simple example of a pedagogy I use, working with high school students as recently as 18 months ago when I was teaching both university and high school courses, as a way to study, I gave them a piece of paper that had a bubble that looked like a Twitter diagram. You have 140 characters or less. Spelling doesn't matter. Grammar doesn't matter. It has to be appropriate to summarize whatever the term was or the fact was the issues. Study by creating a tweet. We're not actually going to Twitter it. We're going to write it down and then share with your partner. And by the time we did three of them, we'd study by having a definition. Now, then they had to turn it in and write it correctly. And now we were ready for that open response or that short answer essay. But just doing that, which isn't very sophisticated, kids were interested because they started to do it the way they're thinking. And they were able to understand it the way they might remember it. And in doing it three times, they repeated it, which sounds old school. And then when they wrote it in appropriate English, they translated and code-shifted to the way I wanted it. Then all of a sudden, more people got it right on the test. So there's some things we can do pedagogically that don't even need a lot of new plug-in devices, just by honoring the way kids are or we are now thinking, which is taking some of the shortcut approaches, which still have to be translated back to what's appropriate for an educational audience. Sometimes. Not even if you work at Google. You know, Google, you get a free lunch, free haircut, you can go play games any time of the day. All this stuff is different. But most of us are preparing people to work in a pretty traditional setting where you want to make sure people aren't just throwing in all the shortcuts unless they run their own company and that's permissible. The mobile devices are what really changed everything, and some of you are in schools where you can bring your own. Some of your schools where you have to turn it off, and we really haven't decided where we're going. But the handheld device means we have a computer in our hand that's about the size of one that used to be the size of this room. We've really got to take advantage because learning can be anywhere at any time. Just as an example, the app Draw Something, maybe you've used that, maybe your children or grandchildren have used that. Draw Something allows you to draw with a partner and ship it to them and have this little competition about drawing, sort of hangman-ish like. It took 50 days to get to 50 million users when it was released. And the radio took 38 years to get to 50 million users. Just the rapid pace of change is quite extraordinary. So what are the implications of this for teaching and learning and schooling? The reason I use the notion of the 22nd century, kind of crossing out the 21st, is just to have something different to say. But it is 2014, nearly 2015, so we're 1/8 of the way there. The great-grandchildren of the kids we have today, or the grandchildren of kids in primary school, is who I believe we're preparing the world for. So if the grandchildren of the kids in primary schools you lead today have a fantastic life, it's going to be because the kids in primary school today have one. So we're getting ready for the next 100 years, not ready for the last 100. My grandmother was in the public schools of New York City 100 years ago right now, probably getting ready for Thanksgiving on the day before Thanksgiving. The building I could take you to, the public school, there's so many schools in New York, they call them PS with a number. Public school 102 is where I went to first, second, and third grade. They ran out of names of famous people, they just started numbering them. So at this, I could take you to her school, still there. The desks are almost identical. There was a blackboard with chalk in 1914. Then we had a green board. Then we had a whiteboard. And now we have a smart board. But the chairs are primarily lined up in rows. They've gone off of the sit-in if you're growing. And teaching is pretty much students watching their teachers work. Now, there's wonderful exceptions to that. And the technology is kind of school, but 100 years, not as much has changed as we might like to think. We're going to have to change it in the next 100 or we really won't need education because the technology is out there with the possibilities that actually make us obsolete if we keep it the same. And the same is true at the university, by the way, because you really don't need to drive to a car park to come listen to me talk. You can watch it up online, or you can get somebody much better anywhere in the world to do so. Unless it's inspiring, unless we create a mindset of really getting actively involved, unless we're doing it for a purpose which seems for the common good rather than just for getting a mark, we'll have missed the mark. And that's the major premise. So what I believe is we have to change the metaphor, change the frame of schooling, and my big ta-da is related to building equity around our thinking of content, pedagogy, and dispositions. The three characteristics of effective teachers are you know what you're teaching, you know how to teach it, and you do it with such a great heart that people want to learn from you. Some teachers have all of that. Some teachers have two or three of those. But the real goal is to get that balance. It's a magical thing when everybody's that enraptured with a lesson with a teacher who has all three components. This is from a school in Melbourne. And if I went to their webpage now, if you just type this in, you'd figure out which school. I'll call it ABC High School. This is what they say their purpose is, their vision of their school is. Committed to providing a safe, secure, and stimulating learning environment where students reach their full potential in a positive culture that engages and supports them. Their well-being and learning outcomes are intrinsically linked, and the school promotes understanding of this in the environment in the classroom. And I really, really like the intent of this statement. I think it's really powerful. If we were going to edit it a bit, it's a bit long. Right? You've been through workshops where you have to come up with this stuff. But I also think it might be missing the boat to say what it really means. What are we preparing young people to do in schools in 2014 and 2015? What's the reason we have them come? I think this sounds like really good-hearted people are going to be there and we're going to try really hard. But I believe if we reframe it around a different perspective, we're preparing young people to be successful in creating knowledge to solve problems that improve the human condition for what I call the collaborative global innovation age. Right, so, collaborative global innovation age. If I were rewriting for you, very presumptuously, your mission or vision statement, for you to edit, I'd say, we prepare young people to be successful in the collaborative global innovation age. To work together to solve problems or create knowledge that help improve the planet, help improve the human condition. Now, we're going to do that. We still need a lot of English. We still need a lot of math. We still need some science. We still need history. But we don't need them in the way we do them now. We can get into some examples in the discussion of the where you see it happening in your schools and where I've seen it happening around Australia and the world because there are schools that are doing this. But most of where it's happening is where a great teacher is doing it in isolation. There's a lot of models that are being perpetuated that seem to work. Others, it may be a distraction. But I think what we still need to come back to is we're not doing this to get high HSCs, high ATARs, high NAPLAN. That should be a result. The purpose should be that children will come and work together to create knowledge or solve problems that improve the planet, that help the human condition. If we got that, then the result is they'll be good citizens, they'll be good partners, they'll vote without having to be fined, they'll, you know, pick up behind themselves, they'll do all the, and they might do very well on the instruments that we'd like them to do well on, that are indicators of that. We're reframing it instead of being the purpose. We are a school of excellence because our kids do well on tests. Is we're a school of excellence because our kids make a difference in the world. And by the way, we don't do so bad on these things that help measure that. That's just putting it there instead of there, and it reframes it because we don't need schools to be those testing centers since we have the technologies. We get to the leadership part in just a little while. I think that might actually be clear about what our role is in that. Good news is, we have a lot to do. This is in Guilford County, North Carolina, where two high school graduates decided in the summer they have the job with the state to paint the crosswalk for the crossing that they didn't have a spell check, and so they got it. They got all the letters right. They just didn't get them in the right order. So in reframing schools, there's plenty of work to do, and it doesn't have to look the same in each school setting. I don't believe in one size fits all. I think it's just represented in this room. There'll be different ways that work for different communities, different values, different ways of thinking. So it's not as if we need a curriculum that says, you do collaborative global innovation aids this way, and you do it the same, please repeat it. It's what works for you, what inspires you in your community and your culture, and what promotes the values of your schools so you can define it the way you'd like. So the technologies really help us drive ourselves forward. I'm not sure if you know this quote, but I think this is another way to say what I said, and that's we really got to ask ourselves what kind of children we want to leave the world more than what world we want to leave our children. That's this forward-thinking, thinking 22nd century, thinking about the grandchildren of your grandchildren or of your children now. That's an interesting, because they better get it, we got to get it right now. My contention is that Australia is poised uniquely in the world with relatively low poverty, with a great democracy and heritage and history and diversity, a great infrastructure, tremendous people power to be the educational leaders that will be that next Finland or the next Singapore, because what we have is we've reframed it around why we actually have schools, not just we want to do the same thing better. That sounds like what General Motors did in the States for 50 years. They built a car that would deliberately break down just about the time your loan was paid off. So either you had to buy GM parts to fix it or get a new car. And I think we've got to change that because GM didn't do so well. The government had to save them, and they're still building a car I don't recommend. So in that sense, we can't repeat those same mistakes of the past. One of the things that this can be misled is, I think a plumber every day gets up to make the world a better place. I think an electrician does, a nurse does, a doctor does, a taxi driver does. That these don't have to change what we do with our lives. We need a lot of different roles. But the reason we do it is we get up to go make a difference. That we're of service. You don't have to hide that in your schools. You can wear that right there on your sleeve. But I'm not sure we make that as much a formal part of the purpose and the curriculum as we should. The reason we're learning this is because in World War I, the way Britain carved up the desert and created this thing like a rock arbitrarily actually created a lot of where Australian young men and women have had to go. This notion of mixing Sunni, Shiite, and Kurds together was never going to work in the way in which it was formed. If we thought democracy and the Western style of democracy is going to work, the value system was going to create what it's created. And if we don't understand that, our kids in the next 50 years will have to go there, or we'll have to build a really big fence around it. There's not even a border between Iraq and Syria now. So the chaos is resulting from not getting a mindset around, how are we going to try to get this right? A two-state solution in Palestine seems to not be possible. What's a solution that could be? We're going to have to get it right. Should Iran have nuclear weapons? Everybody says no. Are we going to stop them? How would we stop? There's all of these issues that seem insurmountable, but if we get it right around the notion of schooling, let's work together to figure it out. Kids are figuring out stuff all the time, turning things around in classrooms and schools, coming up with ideas that are hopeful. We can't leave a world that's more discouraged. We can come up with a solution, and if we get young people empowered in the global network, where we're only one degree of separation on Facebook or Twitter away from Lady Gaga. Imagine, we could tweet Katy Perry while she's doing a show in Sydney last week. We can do this with the important issues that are right before us. So our goal should be to promote opportunity for all children so they're inspired, valued, hopeful, and intellectually curious. I believe my role as a teacher, I taught high school social studies, was that my kids would be so excited they'd be looking forward to next year. And then the next teacher would do it, would just roll forward. Intellectual curiosity is what is the ticket to being a great learner, because it means I'm willing to learn from you, as opposed to learn my own way or my own pace. That intellectual curiosity is what has built most of modern society. What if we did this or this? Our willingness to maybe fail before we succeed, and our willingness to work together to collaborate to get that done. So for the first part of today, I want to stop. This is more me coming at you. We have just a couple minutes before a morning tea to engage in whether blood is blue or red or on some of the things I might have thrown at you. And we'll get to the second part where I'm going to ask you to shape a vision around some of the ideas I'm sharing or take it in a direction that'll work for you. So there's part A, sort of thinking 22nd century, and you've sort of seen my roadmap for that. So thanks so much for being great listeners, and hopefully there's some things we can talk about now in the next few minutes.